Hello, internet. So a week ago, I put out the second single for my upcoming record, Bothered Unbothered, called Decolonize Your Mind. And in this video, we are going to be doing a lyrical breakdown on all of the lyrics in this song. Of all of the songs that I've ever written, this is probably one of the heaviest songs lyrically that I've ever done. There are a lot of themes being portrayed in this song, and I think a lot of the messages are very important, so I wanted to have this type of breakdown for anyone who might be confused by all of the things that I'm talking about in the song. And now, let's give the disclaimer. I am not a political leftist theory YouTuber. This video is not meant to be a source for leftist information. I started learning about all of this stuff over 10 years ago, so all of this information comes from years and years worth of reading books, reading essays, articles, watching documentaries, discussion with other people. So if you want to get mad in the comments and try to argue what I'm talking about, great, boost my video in the algorithm. But I simply just don't have the time and energy to hunt down a citation for every single little thing that I talk about. But I will, however, link lots of resources down in the description. Things like articles and podcasts, other YouTubers who are educators on these types of topics, and suggested books and readings that'll help you get started if this is something you truly want to learn more about. And if you really want to learn about this stuff, the resources will be there. But if you just want to create an argument for the sake of arguing, then I'm going to take that as you don't really want to learn about this in the first place. And you bringing up these points aren't about learning. You bringing up these points are about trying to one-up somebody. Now with that disclaimer out of the way, let's start diving into the lyrics behind Decolonize Your Mind. I've been dreaming of an alternate reality. The first line of this song literally has two meanings. One is quite literal, one is quite not as literal. The idea of this song first actually did come from a dream I had once in which I was playing a show and everyone on the lineup was black. Everyone in the audience was black. It's just everything was black. In fact, in that dream, Fishbone and Soul Glow were also on that show. And a few other bands were also on the show, but they just like didn't exist because it was a dream. And also I was playing in an all black ska band. And it like felt really awesome in the dream, but then when I woke up, I was kind of like, first like, wow, that was such a dope dream, but then immediately was kind of like taken back by it. Because the likelihood of me playing a lineup that is all black at like a punk show or a ska or alternative indie, anything like that, is just very not likely. And so then it got me thinking like, why is that the reason? Why do we live in a society that's like that? And then it kind of got me like actually dreaming of like what a reality would be like if, you know, like colonization, imperialism, slavery, things like that never happened. Going into the next line, free of colonizers severing our history. And this line kind of speaks mostly to like, you know, my experience, the black experience of not knowing where you come from. Colonization and imperialism has destroyed the lives of many groups of people around the world, but I feel like the black experience is a little different from everybody else's. We are actually the only people who really have no idea where we come from. Like, yeah, we come from Africa, but Africa has countless different cultures, societies, religions, things like that. And there's not many groups of people who can say that they actually have absolutely no idea where they come from. With the connection to land and earth identity, never feel like where I belong is a mystery. And so it starts to think about that. Like, you look at all of these like groups of people who exist in the global south, especially a lot of like indigenous people to like whatever lands they come from, and they have that like spirituality, that connection to the earth. They protect the earth, you know, like all of the things that colonization and imperialism destroys. And being a product of like colonization, like the United States just like existing in this country that is destroying the world, kind of seeing what it would be like if, you know, I didn't exist in the imperial core, and what if I was part of one of those groups that is protecting the land, that values the land. Like, what if there was no imperial core that was destroying this land in the first place? And so everybody was part of groups that were protecting the earth. Like, what would that be like? Not a ragtag plastic personality built upon everything we grew up on TV. And so this kind of starts to reference like what it's like, at least for me, growing up in the suburbs in a predominantly white area. Suburban culture is a lot of the American dream, except for there's not really culture there. Like, all of the culture is capitalism. All of the culture is buy, 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 spend, spend, spend. Give up your entire life to own a home in a suburban community. There's no culture to that. There's no art to that. It's very painful. And everything that we build our personalities around is like spending, buying, like getting a house, having a nice car, things that you see all over TV. Even growing up, I remember like having like this like over romanticized idea of like when I get to high school or college and like participate in a frat or whatever, join clubs in school, stuff like that, like things that's not culture. I mean, I guess it technically is, but it's like terrible culture. Isolated in the suburbs from community, kind of dating back again, being like a black person growing up in a predominantly white area. I feel like this is a problem that a lot of black millennials have faced. A lot of our parents from like the boomer generation and even Gen X moved out of like black communities into these predominantly white suburbs to give us a better life. And that really sucks. It kind of isolated us from our own communities. But at the same time, during the time in which that was happening, our communities were being destroyed. In the mid to late 20th century, following the civil rights movement, you saw a rise in a lot of black activism. Activism that was making the communities stronger, and so the response was for the FBI to destroy those communities. Gentrification started to take place, displacing a lot of people in our communities. And basically the entirety of the Nixon and Reagan eras just destroyed the black communities that had spent the civil rights movement being built up. Which truly as a whole kind of left us in this state of isolation with a lot of black folk assimilating into this white American culture. The power is unprecedented in unity. Unity in this situation being the unification of black folk. Like, why was this country so afraid of that? Like, why did the FBI have to put resources into COINTELPRO, a program that destabilized black revolutionary organizations in the 60s and 70s? Why do you have the government constantly destroying successful black communities, whether it's like the Philadelphia Move bombing or like the Tulsa massacres? It seems that one of the biggest fears this country has is the unification of black people, realizing their material conditions is a product of this country failing us. And it gets especially threatening when that solidarity amongst black people starts to become a class solidarity amongst multiple races. It's almost like they realize that people working together is the biggest threat to the system in power. And this last line kind of creates setup into the second verse of this song. There's another reality where the world ain't hurting and niggas like me ain't just surviving, we vibing, living life and children ain't crying. So now this is kind of like mirroring the beginning of the first verse where instead of me like dreaming, it's now me knowing that this other reality could have existed. Again, kind of bringing up the question of what if colonization never happened? What if imperialism never happened? What are the effects of these things? The countries of the imperial core are only so rich because they have siphoned resources, labor, land, from the global south. And the constant stealing from these countries have left the people hurting. America had only become so, the United States have only become so rich so fast because they relied on slave labor to build their economy. And even to this day, the extraction of resources has led to the pollution of the land in the global south that directly impact the people's lives there, while also creating things like coups set up by the United States government that have destabilized countless countries, causing countless massacres and genocide of people in the global south. All this so US corporations can take advantage of those resources and just make their wallets fatter. Because of this, both marginalized groups of people within the imperial core and all of those in the imperial periphery are now fighting to survive as a whole. But imagine if like we just didn't destroy the world to make a few people richer and we didn't have to fight to survive, like we were all just vibing. Well, children aren't suffering because of the actions of the rich. The next line being, or dying from a broken nation, families torn apart, incarceration. This is kind of going back into how people are directly being harmed by the actions of this nation. Especially while speaking about black people, how this nation has historically torn families apart, whether they were families from the slave trade being torn apart and sold as inventory, or families being torn apart in modern day slavery that is the prison industrial complex. Trading hoodie for hipster straight gentrification, this lyric is a nod to No Name. And it talks about how as a country we are afraid of black culture and black folk in general, and how black people's lives can be threatened by that fear for simply doing something like wearing a hoodie. But as a country we are okay when like predominantly white hip people appropriate that black culture. And we would much rather see the appropriation of that culture and white people do that culture than accept black people doing that culture. Like when black people exist as they are, people are afraid of it, but when white people appropriate that culture, they're completely fine with it. Very revealing that the fear doesn't even come from what black people are doing, but the fact that they are black themselves. Which is why they're completely okay with gentrification. And gentrification is a huge thing destroying black communities, displacing these black people out of the homes and places they've lived their entire lives. And the next line, assimilate into a world alienation, kind of dates back to the theme that I brought up in the first verse. You had a lot of black folk moving into the predominantly white suburbs, escaping from their communities that were being gentrified, and over-policing and all that stuff, but the trade-off is now you are assimilating into this white American culture and being alienated from your people. Even with the evil empire reigning, plus every single system working against us, we're still trendsetters, go-getters, with nothing we make a world better. So this starts to bring a new angle to this song, because up until this point, we were talking about how the system has basically destroyed the quality of life for people of color, especially black folk, and how the system constantly works against us and to keep us oppressed. But despite all of that, despite all of the oppression, despite the ways we are constantly being kept down, we as a people still create so much beauty for this world. From slavery to Jim Crow to the war on drugs to modern day, you still have so much beauty being created from the black community. From Black Wall Street to the Harlem Renaissance to the hip hop movement. Basically all music in this country was created and pioneered by black folk. So many brilliant black minds have created so many innovations that we use every single day. And if it wasn't for black innovation, I wouldn't have been able to record this video and you wouldn't be watching this right now. As a people, we have defied the system that keeps us down, and I think there is something really special about that. Could you imagine if we never got robbed, if our land and our labor wasn't stolen by the bourgeoisie, if we weren't targeted by the law? We're able to do so much with this world being literally against us. What if, again, colonization and imperialism never happened? If all of the millions of black people that were displaced out of Africa were able to just be free and exist without all of this, without having their resources stolen? Imagine how far forward we would have been as a world if all of that never happened. Because if we're able to do all of this while being systemically oppressed at the degree we are, imagine if we weren't being oppressed in that way. But we're coming out on top whether you like it or nah. And this is me being a personal believer that no matter what this country does that's evil, no matter what this country does to suppress us, they're not going to win this fight. And as a leftist, it's easy to slip into that doomer mentality where you're like, nothing matters. Like, the powers that be are so powerful and they're going to win. But I personally don't believe that. And I think everything that I've pointed out in the last few minutes of this video truly proves that there is more power and resilience in the people than people want to believe. And as long as there is a dying breath, there will be people who are willing to fight against what's wrong. That being the system. Dystopia is where the system thrives, built off violent screams. The system, again, capitalism, relies off of violence to exist. Those violent screams are the screams of people who were forcibly taken from their homes in Africa, who died on the slave ships, the people who died during the seasoning process in the Caribbean. If you don't know about the seasoning process, go ahead and look that up. It's the screams of families being torn apart and sold to slavery. It's the screams of those who suffered underneath their brutal slave masters. It's the screams of people who were promised freedom but then immediately locked into debt for the rest of their life on sharecrops. It's the screams of black farmers who had their land stolen, mind you, land that was already stolen from the indigenous people. It's the screams of the millions of indigenous lives that were taken for this land to be conquered by the European colonizers. It's the screams of the countless people who exist in the global south, who had their countries invaded and destabilized by the United States government for their interests. It's the screams of those who fell victim to a violent coup and removal of a democratically elected leader just so a company like United Fruit could put in a dictator who allows that company to use their land for them to sell fruit in the imperial core. I can keep going and going and going, but there are better videos on YouTube that can sum up the atrocities this country has committed in the name of building capital. But people are gonna wake up and break up because it's not a dream. This line being a reference to Jeff Rosenstock's No Dream, you're already starting to see signs that people are getting fed up with this system of exploitation. The fact that this country can cancel student loan debt, which would improve the material conditions of literally every citizen in this country, but no leader, regardless of political affiliation, will do the thing that is in the best interest of the people because no political leader in this country have the interest of the people in their mind. And you can only exploit the people so long before they realize that you're not on their side. And they're gonna break up, break away from this system and fight back. We're gonna eat the rich, we're gonna feed the kids when there's nothing left to eat. This being a reference to Bad Operation, eat the rich, feed the kids, but obviously also a reference to the famous term, eat the rich. Because the rich are going to continue to destroy this world to make their pockets fatter. But eventually the water and land is going to be so polluted and climate change is gonna get so extreme where there's going to be lacks of sources of food. And at that point, there will be nothing left to eat but the rich. Meaning they're going to reap the consequences of their mindless destruction of this world just to become richer. And y'all been warned about your greed exploiting for your salaries. Again, referencing the rich, they have been warned. They have spent decades fighting against revolutionaries who have been telling them that the revolution is coming. And when that moment comes and these billionaires and the rich face the consequences for their actions, they can't play stupid. They've been warned. Also, I know that like all of their money doesn't come from their salary pay, but like, y'all, I just needed a rhyme. And lastly, I want to leave off with the chorus. This chorus being sung by Elise from Oceanator. By the way, Oceanator put out a record a few weeks ago. Go ahead and check that out. And oh, I know someday we won't beg and plea for us to be set free from this society. So the idea of that kind of coming up the first time, the idea of more of hope, like maybe hopefully one day that we can be freed from this terrible system that we're in. Maybe one day we could hopefully have a connection to where we come from. Maybe one day. And then as it comes along the second time in the song, it's less of a maybe and more of a we will make this happen. I know that someday we won't have to beg and plea for things like, I don't know, basic rights given to us. We won't have to beg and plea for things like basic housing and food. While someone like Jeff Bezos, let me see, made $8.56 million in the time it took me to record the video and audio for this video. Like, that just shouldn't be allowed. And people like Jeff Bezos, all of these billionaires, with the snap of a finger, could just end poverty. They could solve homelessness, and they choose not to. And they know that they can't do that because if they solve these issues, they could no longer exploit these same people to build the wealth that they have. Which is why they reinforce these systems. That's why the systems that create poverty need to be here. And as long as people live in poverty, as long as people don't have access to basic living needs, we cannot truly be free. As an individual, yes, you can maybe have all of your needs met. But part of the curse that is this capitalist way of thinking is thinking so much about me, myself, when we need to think about the collective, the whole, and make sure that no one gets left behind. So why is the song called Decolonize Your Mind? Well, because it all starts with the self. Before we talk about tearing down these systems that exist around us, we first need to upbuild new systems and imagine a better world. And in order to do that, you need to start unlearning all of the toxic things that you have taught your entire life about the world. And I actually want to end this video with a little quote from this book. We Do This Till We Free Us by Miriam Kaba. I've been reading this book recently. I've read a few works out of this book already before, and I just started reading the whole book from front to back. So this is a beautiful book. If the idea of abolition or tearing down this terrible system we live in is something that you've never really thought about before, I highly recommend reading this book. Miriam Kaba has been doing incredible work in the world of prison abolition and transformative justice. And she published this book in 2020 when people were starting to talk about defunding and abolishing the police. Because a lot of people can't imagine a world without the police, and that's where this book and like the ideas of transformative justice and abolition in general really come in handy. In this book, she writes, "Changing everything might sound daunting, but it also means that there are many places to start, infinite opportunities to collaborate, and endless imaginative interventions to experiment and create. Let's begin our abolition journey, not with the question, what do we have now and how can we make it better? Instead, let's ask, what can we imagine for ourselves and for the world? And if we do that, then boundless possibilities of a more just world awaits us." The imagination is important. If you can't imagine a better world, we cannot create a better world. And that's the idea of decolonizing your mind. Once again, this book and many others will be linked down below as resources for you to get started learning about this stuff. And thank you so much for watching if you made it this far into the video. If you want to argue down in the comments, go ahead and do that. It'll only boost me in the algorithm even more. And if you want to continue supporting this channel, might I consider pledging over on Patreon? As you know, we live in a society that requires us to pay money for basic human needs despite having the resources to just supply it for everybody. And Patreon is the thing that allows me to be able to cover all of those needs as well as cover any expenses for this channel. In exchange, I can keep creating art for y'all here on YouTube and all of my other social media platforms. And remember, there's power in numbers. Even if you can only donate as much as a dollar a month, if enough of y'all do that, that is more than enough for me to do what I do. And in return, you get lots of cool rewards, like your name at the end of the videos, access to Discord, or even bonus content. Everything is linked below. Thank you so much for being here. All right, bye! Everyone on Patreon.